Dubai International Airport, one of the fastest growing airports on the planet and aiming to be number one.
Clear for takeoff.
But perfection is never easy.
Final call, Emirates to Sydney.
More planes.
The flight has departed.
More passengers.
Absolutely ridiculous.
I need extra manpower here at transfer desk.
And massive construction just to keep up.
So much scaffolding everywhere. Nothing is finished.
It's non-stop.
If you don't love it, it's just gonna kill you.
24/7.
I think it's stuck. One, two, three, push!
It's the job of 60,000 staff from all over the world.
It's either you can deliver or you're out of the building.
To make this the ultimate airport. An airport the size of Dubai International needs to run like clockwork. Staying on time is critical to the smooth running of this 24-hour operation. Delay in any department has major consequences throughout the whole airport. This applies more to air traffic control than anywhere else. With 140 airlines flying to over 260 destinations from only two runways, air traffic control has to keep it all flowing smoothly.
Stay with me, wind 1605 knots, clear takeoff 30 right.
Minus frequency, wind 180 degrees.
It's the middle of the early morning rush, with the late night turnarounds waiting to depart. Air traffic controllers have to manage planes in the air and on the ground. It's a highly stressful job that requires the ability to make critical decisions under pressure. Tess Toogood, an experienced air traffic controller, is handling all ground movements.
It's learning how to take 3D and turn it into 4D, and the fourth one is time. And so when you're working, in your mind, you're always planning ahead 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes. Where will all those aircraft be then?
A plane has just landed with technical difficulties.
We're at 39, okay, emergency in progress.
I'll get back to you in about 2 or 3 minutes.
They had smoke showing from behind, not quite sure where it's from, maybe a tire, maybe something else. So he's holding on the taxiway. The fire trucks are coming out to have a closer look, see what's happening.
As more information comes in, fire is quickly ruled out.
As the aircraft touched down, he burst a tire. And so he managed to come off of the runway and then is held just off the runway. You don't want them to taxi very far in case there is a lot of debris coming off.
Fortunately, in this instance, all passengers and crew are safe, but the runway might not be.
If he's left debris on the runway, say a burst tire that's shredded everywhere, then it's a bigger problem.
Debris on runways can cause accidents. It can be sucked into jet engines, causing damage and even fires. The runway is shut down, and its closure will have a big impact on all airside operations.
Airside 55. So we've got a single runway, so that we have time to do a thorough runway check. Emirates 107. We just have a closed runway to emergency aircraft, so we're just going down a single runway now. I'll call you back in a few minutes when we're sorted.
A shredded tire means the possibility of rubber on the runway. The airside operation team have been called to carry out an inspection.
Emirates 15, okay, we just have to go down to single runway. We've had a bit of a problem and there'll be delays now, so probably about 10 minutes.
With landing intervals averaging 3 minutes, planes will now need to circle and wait for the one remaining runway to become available. Tess can't keep them waiting for long.
We don't have a very large airspace here, so if we send a few around, they start mixing with the rest of our arrivals and we get too many. We can't really hold in our airspace, so that means that the two holding bays we have in the air just outside our airspace will fill up very quickly. So if you can look at our stacks, if you go out on the radar, you can see how full they're getting.
At one of the busiest airports in the world, operating with just one runway causes real pressure.
So because we've had a runway closure, it'll be maybe 10 to 15 minutes with a runway closure, it backs up our departures. So as the departures back up, we're going to get big delays. At the moment, there's only five waiting, but it snowballs quite quickly. It's a heavy departure time of day.
Getting the runway operational is out of Tess's hands.
Meanwhile, the runway is being checked by a couple of vehicles who are out there picking up all of the debris. When they clear it and tell us the runway's back, we'll go back to two runway operation.
Emirates 87, thanks for waiting. Hold position, contact
ground, moment
835.
Yeah, I'll put you in my queue, thanks. You're number 5 at the moment.
Sounds good, Emirates 151.
707, thanks. Hold position, just stay with me.
Coming by Emirates 707.
After a 15-minute delay, Tess finally gets the news she's been waiting for.
I firm. Yep, both runways are now open. Crossing now.
It'll take Tess half an hour to get the backlog of departures cleared.
Some days are very by the book and a bit dull, but most of the time, you sit in the right seat, you can have a lot of fun. Cross runway 30 right and pop a 2 echo 6.
...85% of Dubai's population is expatriate, coming from over 200 countries worldwide. And today is the beginning of the Christmas migration home. It's one of the busiest days in the airport's history.
Wow, this is busy.
As airport services manager, it's Mel Saparwal's job to ensure this exodus makes it through the airport to their departure gates in time for boarding.
17,000 transfer load this morning, coupled with 11,000 joining, is quite a number.
That's 28,000 passengers in the morning rush.
A lot of activity here today. I want to make sure that everything's running smoothly. Have a look at the passenger list of missing and ask the GTL to offload. We've got some congestion in the baggage systems as well, so that's going to have an impact on the operation. I'm starting to get a little bit worried. Let's have a look for you.
Minutes later, Mel has to deal with her first passengers of the day, a family with young children. The gate for their flight to Mumbai has just closed. But the plane is still on the tarmac and isn't scheduled to take off for another 7 minutes.
Your flight is not gone.
We require you to be at the gate 20 minutes before departure time. I know you did your best.
The queues out there are so much.
I know. It's a very, very busy day. We are checking. Okay, you're not allowing me to speak. The flight has departed. All right, but I can only hear one person. All right, just give us a few minutes. We'll see what we can do.
Mel turns detective to find out why these passengers arrived late.
Was there a gate change on this flight?
No.
No gate change?
No more.
And what time was the check-in done?
Oh, okay, thank you.
These passengers had cleared through the scanning process at check-in at 8:30. So if we allow for the congestion, it really doesn't give them enough time to get to Concourse C. All right.
Mel establishes that the passengers were not late checking in, so it might be down to congestion.
Sometimes you might get scenarios that are quite heart-rending and you can fully understand the situation of the person involved. It's always very, very important that you remain calm.
I have an option for you in 4 hours. Do you wish to take that option? This flight has departed.
Heading back with babies, how can you expect customers to go out there, walk and come back down?
Well, duty-free
for no reason at all.
I totally understand.
No way.
Okay. Let me give you the option to travel on the next flight. Do you wish to take that option?
We don't have any other option, right?
Okay. Do you want to take a seat inside here and we'll start your processing?
This is not fair. I will never come again by Emirates.
Okay.
How can the flight go without taking the passengers?
Based on the circumstances and because she's traveling with children and based on the timings that are in the system, we're going to accommodate her on the afternoon flight.
We're kind of shocked to see the queues here. We never expected we've traveled to this airport before. And we are walking towards the destination. Yeah. Not that we're wasting any time. We've missed our flight. It's very sad, though.
Okay, which flight? We've got your next boarding cards for your next flight. So the first thing I need you to do is just to check that you've got all your passports.
2 minutes later, Mel's called to deal with another passenger who has missed her flight to Dakar.
It's too late. Offloaded. You've missed your flight. The time. 9:55.
How to do now?
Now you have to make another booking for the next flight.
Where?
The transfer desk.
Transfer desk.
We guide you to transfer desk.
Me?
I will guide you to the transfer desk.
This lady on the car. I tell him help me. She don't help me.
Oh, that's a shame.
I tell him help me. My flight will go.
Where did you come in from anywhere, or you came from Dubai?
From Jeddah.
From Jeddah. Okay. Right. Well, let's get a booking done. Yep.
Mel thinks that the problem is not airport congestion, but the passenger's sense of direction.
Well, she's not found her way because her flight is boarding through Concourse B and she's ended up in Concourse C.
We have to go together to the other side to make for your new booking.
Yes.
She'd actually only crossed through the screening area outside at check-in at 9:12 to be exact, so that gives her only 15 minutes to reach her gate. And obviously, she's not going to make that in 15 minutes.
But Mel decides to exercise discretion and organizes a seat on the next flight to Dakar, leaving tomorrow morning.
It's my job to prioritize and to assess and to evaluate and see what the next course of action is.
For this passenger, Mel has arranged a complimentary night at the airport hotel. £57 million passengers travel through Dubai International Airport every year. That's a potential 6,000 passengers an hour, all needing clear direction to their departure gates. Today, every single one of the 750 gate signs in the three terminals is going to be changed from numbers to letters and numbers. And because Dubai is open 24 hours a day, it all has to happen while the airport is fully operational. If it goes wrong, passengers may be confused, lost, and miss their flights. The man in charge of the operation is Mazhar Butt.
Right, good morning, everybody. Great. Thank you very much for coming today. It's a historic day for Dubai airports, because I don't think any other large airport in the world would even attempt to do what we're doing today. We're going to change close to 800 signs in about 8 hours in a live airport operation.
Any passenger confusion during the sign change could lead to chaos. 100 extra personnel have been enlisted to ensure passengers have the assistance they need if things don't go exactly to plan.
Their duties today will be specifically to make sure all passengers understand where their gates are, and if they are confused about the gates, they'll make sure they can give them some information, give them a map, and guide them to their gates.
Tim Woodstock is Mazar's number two. It's his job to liaise with the teams on the ground and keep Mazar up to date with progress.
Into the teams, you take away your teams, and Khalil Noor will take over and help you. No hiccups so far. Looks like we've got things on plan. Fingers crossed.
It's an operation that needs to be managed meticulously.
What we should do is start recording everything on the maps here.
Yeah, we could do. Yeah.
We can go through the map bit by bit once progress is over to find out where the issues are and direct a team out there. Keep it simple. We've got a plan. Let's follow the plan. Good enough to go, isn't it? Straightforward enough. You know, we've planned it to the nth degree now. Not much more we can do, is there? Right, so good luck, guys. Let's do it. I hope we're all up for it.
Research has shown that combined letters and numbers is easier to follow than numbers only. The switchover has to happen as quickly as possible, so passengers don't get confused between the old and the new signs. But there's a catch. First, they remove the old number signs. Then they attach the new letter and number signs. And finally, they stick on temporary old ones. As soon as the teams get the green light from Mazar, the old signs can be ripped off to reveal the new ones.
when the systems all change over, we literally just have to reveal that sign, and then within a matter of seconds, that sign has then changed from old content to new.
With the CEO of Dubai Airport, Paul Griffiths, checking on progress, the team is under real pressure to deliver.
We thought, for customers who don't perhaps travel that often, much easier to memorise an alpha letter and two numbers. So A12 is easier than 312.
So, Maz, all going?
All going to plan, touch wood.
Excellent. This has the feel of Bandits 100 plus, you know, about it, doesn't it? It's a real sort of war room here. In a live environment, there is no second chance here. We can't suddenly stop aeroplanes arriving and departing. So somehow the team have got to get this away and get it done in the shortest possible time. If we get a glitch, then the knock-on impact could be massive and very quick to build up.
They all know what they have to do. They should be working as per the plan in their allocated zones. If you can just give me a quick update every 15, 20 minutes.
Just as Mazar is about to go live with the signage switchover, up in HQ...
And do you want to keep them all in C1, or do you want to put some in C1 and some in C2?
He gets a call from Tim Woodstock informing him that one of the crews responsible for changing the signs has gone missing.
Well, they should be there by now. Why aren't they there? They should be there by now.
Exactly that, right?
OK, well, there's no... The ball arms for the brakes, and they're supposed to come back to C1 straight away. What about all the signs down the middle? Because that should be happening right now as well.
Unless Mazar gets his crews back quickly, his carefully planned operation could miss the deadline. Dubai International is expanding to accommodate 15 million more passengers. They need a new concourse, and they need it quickly. This $3.2 billion building is the answer. Keeping up to 17,000 construction workers on track to deliver it within a demanding schedule calls for a tough, no-nonsense boss.
Morning!
Suzanne Al-Amani.
The west should be finished, then from the center going east. You know, all these panels around the escalators and all these stainless steel and bits and pieces...
With the completion date under a month away, Suzanne has called in the main contractors to check the build schedule is on target.
OK, how long it will take you to finish installation?
In 3 to 4 weeks, we should be...
3 to 4 weeks?
Yes, this is our target, but obviously this is a conservative target and we'll try to finish earlier than that.
For everybody, honestly, now, there is no more room to hide things. You know, we have to finish.
Suzanne decides to see for herself.
It's the final push. It's really the final push. Sometimes, you know, you have to apply pressure and disregard the human factor. Sometimes you have to be very sympathetic with them. You know, you have to try so many tactics to reach your goal finally, you know, completion.
Right now, Suzanne's main concern is the first floor. But the escalator isn't working.
Here we start. How many times we said this should remain operational?
First stop for Suzanne is the retail and restaurant area.
This is the Shake Shack.
Where construction seems to be at a standstill.
Is that it for the ceiling?
Yeah, well, only they have to. They need
and
to
I don't,
put only
I don't
the,
see
the
anybody
pipes.
From their side here. Nobody's here.
It's Friday, a day off in Dubai. But this close to the delivery deadline, Suzanne expects to see people working. The next unit, a burger bar, is also unfinished.
Where is their seating?
It's coming.
Part of the
so
equipment.
The seating is not here?
Seating, cladding.
Cladding.
Cladding here. This cladding.
Disaster.
And it gets worse.
These were not supposed to be finished yesterday?
They were, yeah.
And? Do they have any foreman, anybody here?
Yeah, the foreman.
Suzanne prepares to make her feelings clear to this subcontractor.
Where is the foreman?
But he doesn't speak Arabic or English.
Translator!
Joseph.
So someone else has to tell this contractor to get used to working through his weekends.
Now it's holiday, okay? Not too many people coming, going on the road. You can finish this work. 2 days. Today and two more days.
Abdi, I don't mean, disturbance.
This
guys, they are not our contractors. We have no control over them. You know, the only thing we can do really is to put maximum pressure on them, threaten them, we throw them out, you know, throw their materials out, whatever is not installed.
Wherever Suzanne looks, the subcontractors are behind schedule.
But here it still looks like a construction site. And here, this guy with the beam seating, come on, he should have finished.
Concourse furniture is still in plastic wrapping. And again, the workers are not on site.
Well, his people should be here and they should be assembling. Where are these people?
Today they are not here.
Why today they are not here?
Now, there's a team working on it.
I don't see anybody working on it.
No, not this particular one, no.
You know, no excuses.
And it's not just the workforce that's absent. Materials are also missing.
When are we getting these pieces here?
Within the next 2 or 3 days. Plenty of panels are coming in from the factory now.
I want to see really a dedicated team on these things.
Before the panels can even be fitted, yet another subcontractor has to connect the water supply.
Okay. What is missing here from your side?
The connection is there tomorrow. Maybe.
Tomorrow you make connection.
Yeah, but other than that, we are ready.
You know, we are at a time in the project where we have plenty of small things. All these small things, they will turn out to be, you know, impossible to finish. That's a problem. You know, it's not difficult, it's not bulky stuff. It is small things which take forever to finish.
Even when the right materials are on site, they can't be installed because the subcontractors don't know where they are.
Finished. Come here. Yes? Is this finished? What is the problem here? The cladding is here. I want to see it finished. Coordination.
Tomorrow.
Coordination. Okay, let's continue.
Suzanne's seen enough. No more weekends. Better management.
Something has to be done. I think you have from now up to Monday, close of business, to get your act together, all of you, and sort everything out. Really.
Suzanne has given her team 3 days to get the build back on schedule. The airport's service department is about to change every single one of the departure gate signs, while the airport is fully operational. It's an ambitious plan, and one of the teams has gone missing.
We need to make sure the teams are back in location now.
Mazar Butt is the man in charge.
The project manager for ES has confirmed that they're all there and back working again.
OK.
With all the teams in place, Mazar gives the green light to start the sign switchover.
Only in Dubai Airport. Only in Dubai Airport would we try this. Confirmed gate 232, now Bravo 17.
This is the critical stage of the switchover, where passengers could easily be confused because the old gate signs and the new ones are being displayed at the same time in different parts of the airport.
Copy, gate 231, now change to Bravo 19er.
To avoid passengers arriving late at gates and delaying departures, the staff need to make sure customers aren't confused. Mazar's team are off to a good start.
Mazar, calling Mazar.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, central signage from gates 101 to 106 is now Bravo 1 to Bravo 16, complete.
That's gates 101 to 106, now Bravo 1 to Bravo 1.
Affirm, new signage takeover is completed.
Let's not get complacent.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, I keep everything crossed for you.
Well, nature of the airport is anything can go wrong at any moment, so we have to be prepared for anything between now and close of play. And we still have a few hundred signs to change, so until we get the signs changed, we're not going to start saying we're done for the day.
The target is by midnight tonight, not have anyone wandering around the terminal still trying to find one of the old gates.
With Bravo 14, we only had one issue with passengers at their gate that was a live flight. They actually got confused in the beginning, but that was rectified on spot, so no issues or impact on that gate.
What about the scrolling message and the C1 face?
It's already removed.
That's okay, right.
Looks done.
Yeah, fine.
Confirm all signage change at Terminal 2.
Affirmative. Signage change of all
Fantastic, great.
Well done, guys. Well done.
Excellent.
750 signed changes and not a single complaint. Fantastic. So I think we deserve a bit of a celebration today. We'll have a cup of tea and some biscuits.
At Dubai International Airport, over 900 flights arrive and depart a day, about one every 90 seconds. Making sure that the airport is safe for all this traffic is the responsibility of airside operations, who see to everything from parking planes to removing dangerous trash from taxiways. Airside controllers have to maneuver on live runways, demanding and always potentially dangerous. New recruits must learn how to get around the apron quickly and safely. And just like any other driver, they're tested before being let loose on the runway.
So, we're going to do your manoeuvring area driving competency check today.
OK.
So,
John Taylor is taking a new recruit on his airside driving test.
OK.
Just remember, your ultimate aim is safety while you're driving out here, okay? OK? If you're not sure, then stop. If you need to ask me, that's fine, it's not a problem.
OK, sir.
Ali is retaking the test. Last time, he didn't listen or follow instructions.
OK,
sir. OK, so if you want to start your walk around...
I'll do that.
Now, it's up to trainer John to assess him again.
The test is a pass or fail test. Obviously, with something as critical as driving on the manoeuvring area, we can't say, yeah, he's about 50%, we'll let him go. He's got to be 100% accurate.
With over a decade of experience, John knows the hazards involved with driving airside.
The major issue would be what we call a runway incursion. That's a vehicle actually going onto the active runway while there's aircraft landing or taking off. Could result in a collision, and then that in turn could result in fatalities.
Ali has 45 minutes to prove to John he's now competent enough to drive airside.
OK, you ready?
Yep.
Happy?
Yeah.
Vehicle all checked?
Yep.
Very good.
On a runway or manoeuvring area, airside operation controllers are managed by air traffic control, just like pilots. So communication skills are vital.
We're looking at a number of factors with Ali. We're looking at how good his radio transmissions are, his position on the taxiway. We're actually going to use the closed runway so that we can assess his radio transmissions.
Ali's still a rookie, so isn't allowed on a live runway. Fortunately, one of them is scheduled for closure. He just needs to get there, safely.
We'll be entering the runway via Kilo 1. Call sign is going to be Ops 2. Treat it as it's a live runway, OK?
Yes, sir.
OK, off you go.
Dubai Tower, Ops 2.
Ops 2, Dubai Tower, go ahead.
Holding at Kilo 1, requesting for runway inspection, 30 left. Ops 2.
2, proceed runway 1 to right.
Proceed runway 1 to left.
First radio transmission and his first mistake. Confusing left and right. Right is the closed runway. Left, an operational one.
1 to right.
1 to right, Ali.
Correction, 1 to right. Ops 2.
Air traffic control and John correct Ali. But if he'd been on his own, it could have been dangerous.
OK, you've got to be sure on the message that you're passing back. OK, you just answered back without thinking. You got the 30 left, you 1 2 right confused, OK?
Ali heads out to the test runway, while John tries to deliberately distract him by asking questions.
And if your vehicle should break down, what would you do?
I'll call first ATC that my vehicles have broke down.
Okay.
So it will take a few minutes, or it will take some time to recover it, and I'll call my Audma to send me any team or any...
Just called you, and you haven't heard.
Distracted by John's questions, Ali has totally missed a radio call from air traffic control.
Operation performing runway 1 to right inspection. Did you copy?
Second, please.
You need to give way to air traffic crossing the runway from Kilo 10 11.
Give way to traffic from Kilo 10. Yes, Ops 2.
This is a vital message. An Airbus A340 is about to cross the closed runway. Ali must give way. He nearly misses the warning. Another mistake.
OK, so you've got to make sure you're listening to this, OK? You've got to keep an ear out. Even when you're talking or you're doing anything else, you've just got to keep an ear out for your call sign or for anything to do with the runway or your location, OK? Said give way to this aircraft. Said give way to the 340. For that being the 340.
So far, not so good for Ali. Emirates Airline is currently the world's largest operator of the Airbus A380, the biggest passenger aircraft on the planet. Over in the vast heavy maintenance hangar, one of the airline's 31 A380s is undergoing routine maintenance checks. Mian Talat Abbas, an aircraft engineer with over 30 years of experience, is heading up the inspection.
That's my job, my profession, my hobby. That's the only thing I know how to do. So.
The Airbus A380 is undergoing a C check, an extensive inspection and overhaul, which can take up to 6,000 man hours to complete. Attention to detail is vital.
That's the whole concept of this heavy maintenance, you know, to ensure everything is working perfectly, because there is no margin of error in our business.
Mian Talat has spotted that a hydraulic hose in the engine is missing a small component.
It has one locking pin missing here. This is a hydraulic hose which goes all the way up to the pylon in the engine, which is a really big part. We are supposed to replace the whole pipe. I just wanted to explore the possibility if we can replace the pin in situ, in place, without dismantling the component.
Mian Talat needs to check with his production engineer if the locking pin can be replaced without removing and replacing the whole hose.
See on number 3 engine? Yeah. It's just a pin missing. It's absurd. You know, for this missing pin, if we are replacing the whole hose, I don't think it's really justified. I mean, if we have to do it, we have to do it. But if you would like, I will show you this on the engine. Then maybe you can appreciate what I'm saying. Right.
It could save time and money, but needs to be safe.
Pin missing. This handle has a pin missing. For this pin, we have to replace this whole hose assembly, which goes up to the pylon. Okay. So it doesn't seem very logical.
The production engineer will have to check with the plane's manufacturer for approval on Mian Talat's fix. While Mian Talat waits to find out, one of his team have identified another problem on the right inboard engine.
Okay, let's go for this one first. Yeah? This is a drag link for a thrust reverser, which we found during the inspection. This is getting worn out from one side. Now we were gonna replace this with a new one.
It is an important component that helps reverse the thrust of the jet engine to bring this 386-ton aircraft to a halt.
Mirror, where is my mirror? Hold this. Okay, this is fine. Okay, John, let's talk it up, huh?
Even though Mian Talat has over 30 years of experience, strict rules insist that all work is checked.
Yeah, for the chafing. It was an inspection finding. Just have a look, please. It's just a safety net so that the critical installations are correct every time. Thanks, Jason. Thank you. Don't take my torch and mirror. Ah, it's yours. Cool, good.
Installation approved. Mian Talat and his team manually check that the drag link is functioning properly.
Okay, Adil. Enough. Perfect. Beautiful. This is done.
And Mian Talat finally gets the green light for the money-saving idea he had earlier.
Airbus said it's fine. You can fly the aeroplane without replacing the whole pipe assembly. I managed to save a component, so it is good.
Wannabe airside ops controller Ali Kadir is taking his airside driving test to assess if he can drive safely on live runways where planes land and take off. He got off to a bad start. He needs to improve his radio comms to stand a chance of passing. Instructor John Taylor offers some advice.
Listen to what he's saying, okay? Take your time to answer him back. Okay, analyze, or listen to what he's telling you, take it in, make sure you've got all the correct information, and call him back.
Runway 12R, vacated via Mike 7. Ops 2.
So you can proceed now, Mike 7, proceed runway 12R.
Proceed runway 12R via Mike 7. Ops 2.
Well done, that's good to see. Nice and easy, let it flow. Don't try and sound like a robot. And you thought about what you were saying then.
Proceed runway 12R and stop bar, please. Ops 2.
Go for now, thank you.
Confirm. Ignore.
The stop bar and then maintenance, you can proceed runway
12R. Proceed runway 12R, YMX 17, ops 2.
Okay, give him a chance to answer.
Ali has jumped the gun and needs to wait for a response from control.
Remember, it's not just you, he's looking at everybody on the airfield, okay? He's looking at crossing the aircraft. He's got helicopters landing, he's got people going down the taxiways. So it might be that he can't answer you straight away.
Runway section of exam over.
Runway 30, I've been getting inspected. Ops 2. Thank you, sir.
Time for the taxiway, mixing with planes maneuvering to and from the gates. Driving alongside pilots who, at 15 meters from the ground, might not even be able to see him.
What are we going to do about this aircraft?
I'll just go on the left side.
Okay.
And I'll go on Zulu.
How would we be able to know what he's doing?
Because I'll just monitor the frequency.
Okay, what?
Ali failed to switch his radio from air traffic control to ground control when he left the runway.
Best thing to do is actually switch it to ground. Okay? Then you can keep an ear out. You've got visual on this runway. Okay, what's the safe distance to cross in front of an aircraft?
300 meters.
And behind?
200 meters.
Okay,
good morning.
What would happen if you drive onto an active runway, so you drive over a stop bar? What would that be called?
A runway incursion.
Okay, what could happen with a runway incursion?
There'll be no more landings because it's unsafe. And so ATC, they cannot give permission for any of the aircraft to land because they don't know if runway is safe or not.
John has seen enough.
So we'll stop, get out of the car, have a quick chat.
It's the moment of truth for Ali.
Need to work on your listening skills a little bit more. You need to listen out for your call sign or listen out for the area that you're operating in. There was once that he did call and you completely forgot about it. Your airfield knowledge is good. You've got an idea of the signage, of where you are, and you know the emergency procedures. So again, that's a good thing. You have an understanding of the runway incursions and obviously what can happen. So that's one of our major points as well. Okay, well, it's gives me pleasure to say well done, you passed, okay? This is only the start of your learning journey on a maneuvering area. Just get yourself out there, drive around, learn more and more. Okay, and then hopefully over time we can bring you onto the runway, start teaching you about the runway inspections, get you signed off as Cat 1. But well done. Okay.
Despite his mistakes, John believes Ali has shown enough promise to move to the next level. He will now be granted limited access to airside while in control of a vehicle. Emirates is one of the fastest growing airlines in the world. To keep its planes in the air, it constantly needs to train new cabin crew. New recruits are put through 7 weeks of intensive training at Aviation College, with safety the priority. Today's class is how to deal with an emergency evacuation. The lesson is overseen by training specialist Fiona Devlin.
At the end of the day, there's a requirement that we see them do this professionally and safely, because it is something that hopefully never, but they may require passengers to do, and we need to know that they're confident doing it and that they could confidently conduct an evacuation themselves. Okay, guys, walk upstairs to the upper deck and just get ready near the UL1 door for where we'll give you the brief about the sliding. Okay, so just go upstairs.
The giant Airbus A380 has 16 escape slides, and from the top deck, it's a drop of 8 meters. To qualify as a flight attendant, Sylvia Fernandez has to pass the test.
Oh my God, it's really high. This is the big stuff. I'm a bit scared.
Roughly about the height of a three-story building. Of course, you know, we try our best to support them and give them a little push down the slide. They don't have the option to back out. It is definitely one of the boxes that needs to be ticked for their training.
Sylvia is well aware of what's at stake.
At the end of the day, we are talking about saving lives and safety. You need to stop, know what you're doing, and then act, because they are depending on you, so you better do it right.
We want you to lean as far forward as possible, as if you're trying to touch your toes. At no point of time, you will touch the raft. Clear? All right, one person at a time. At no time, more than one person on the raft. And we're gonna take it from there. Are we ready, the engineers?
Yeah, take a seat here on the balcony. Lean forward, try to touch your toes, look ahead. Yep. All right, Sylvia?
Yep.
Okay, take a seat here on the balcony. Okay, try to touch your toes. Lean forward and look straight ahead.
Good.
Oh my God, it was great, it was great. Very nice, yeah. Oh my God, it's very high. It's amazing how high it is.
Well done.
Good. Okay, next.
The final test is how to deal with an emergency evacuation into water.
Inflate your life jacket, sit and crawl. Inflate your life jacket, sit and crawl.
Hey, come. Guys, come on.
Inflate
time.
Your life jacket, sit and crawl. Inflate your life jacket, sit and
I'm
crawl.
So looking forward to going in the water.
Jacket,
they said it's very cold. I actually like cold water because I live by the Atlantic Ocean.
Inflate your life jacket, sit and crawl. Inflate your life jacket, sit and crawl.
Come. Hey, guys, come on.
Before entering the water, they have to know how to detach the escape chute and turn it into a raft.
14 kilograms, so your body weight, basically.
In a real emergency, this raft has an overload capacity for up to 85 people.
Now they're going to be entering the water from the other end of the slide raft, and they'll be doing some activities in the water about how to prevent hypothermia and how to survive longer if they're in the sea.
Go ahead. All right, Carla, well done. Now, I want you all to huddle.
This isn't just team bonding. It's an essential survival technique for freezing seas.
Are you okay, Sarah?
It's important that it's cold, because what we're asking them to do now is to try out different positions to reduce the likelihood of hypothermia. And they do see that when it's cold and they adopt these positions, they can feel the warmth. So it's more realistic if we have it as cold as we can.
All right, you can leave the swimming pool. Thank you.
Cold.
It's actually quite warm today. I don't think they put the chillers on very well this morning, so I don't know what they're complaining about.
So, you know, we are now in the pool. I guess when you are in the ocean, that's really scary.
Today is a big milestone for them. It's a good sense of achievement. They've passed. They should feel very proud of themselves.
You saved my life.
And now they're moving on to their medical training and their security training before they then are given their wings and they can start flying. Yeah.
If all goes well, within 4 weeks, these trainees will be flying.
Next, in Russia's toughest prisons, meet a man who boiled, fried, and ate his victim, and one who killed his brother-in-law for disturbing his daughter's sleep.